What's up, people? Welcome to our neighborhood. I hope you can hear me. I just wanted to create a video based on what I've been doing recently. So let me open up the MIU Explorer version 7. Too big. Now, the MIU formal system, let's look at that, and then I'll explain to you how this, or a sequence of numbers arises sort of naturally from the MIU formal system. So you can imagine that it's a game like chess, okay? And except in this system there's no victory or loss, but only moves. And what moves are strings. Strings are lists or sequences of other things, usually numbers, but also could be any set. So in chess, you have the axiom, which means the starting position is always the same for every chess match. And these four rules here define what this MIU formal system does. So it's a string rewriting procedure. So if you can recognize this arrow as an if then. If a string ends in I, then if the string ends in I, and if XI is a theorem, then XIU is also a theorem. And then an example is MI to MIU. So remember, MI is like the axiom, okay? So here, and in one inference, or because of one rule, we have a proof actually of MIU, which is MI and then MIU, and MIU is one application of rule number one. Rule number two says that for a string starting in M, well, actually all the strings have to start in M. It should say that somewhere. All strings have to start with an M. So I would improve on this notation a little because, well, see like rule three, there's no M, but that's because it just says you can cancel any three I's with and replace it by one U. And then rule four is if you find a string with two consecutive U's here, then they cancel out. So a formal explanation is remove that. So you've probably seen that. And a solution is kind of cool, but I wanted to draw your attention to this notebook, and these are those rules. So this is one of the rules. If it ends in I, then you can add an extra U. Okay. Another one is this string doubling rule. The string doubling rule is not mentioned yet because I didn't talk about it in the order. Rule number two is if you have any string, mx, doesn't matter how long or short, mxx is a theorem so long as mx is a theorem. And an example of that would be MIU. You double to IU, so it's IU, IU. That's what they mean by doubling. Like, literally, just copy the string. Remember, this is just a string rewriting, like, system. It's in a sense, extremely meaningless. But what it's good for is, like, there's an algorithm out there. It was discovered about 20 or so years ago. And in context, the book this came out in 1979, so let's just call it the 80s. About 20 years after that book came out, there was this article that gives a automated theorem prover for the MIU formal system. In other words, if you give it any string, it will provide you with a proof of that. If you give it any theorem, it'll provide you the proof of that theorem. And that doesn't violate incompleteness because this system cannot model arithmetic. First order logic and set theory does model arithmetic, but the MIU system does not model arithmetic. So there's no such thing as a prime number in here. In fact, there's no numbers, it's all strings. And a string, it could have your own, you could interpret it, I'm sure, in a number of ways. But I think what the author meant to basically say is that, like, I is for human intelligence, and then U is for Zen mode, or something like that, because mu means, like, damn, that was a stupid question, or I, like, cannot answer your question because it's already full of, like, assumptions or something, you know? And, so it's amazing that just from these four rules comes so much. And, you would think it would be simpler than this, but it's not. So now going back to how to do this in Mathematica, MIU next. So this defines a function where S is a string and rule is actually a number, just some number. We want a string to replace the input S, and then we cite the MIU rules. G is new function. I want to, let's start from the innermost part, which is here. The innermost part's here. So, the part where it says, am I in quotes, and I don't know why I'm pointing at my screen because you can't see what I'm pointing at. That's the axiom, okay, like a starting position in a chess match. And in this game, there's four rules. And let's say that you're on the country, same country as MI, if it is possible to connect you with it through a graph. There's four colors on this graph. Count them. Four. There are four rules of inference in the MIU system. MIU next, XN, basically what that does is, assuming that the string X is true, the table means I'm listing MIU next for a constant x, which is going to be supplied by me later, You can see I'm going from 1 to 4. It assumes that I'm going in increments of 1, so I'm doing 1, 2, 3, and 4. And MIU next is telling me all consequences that are one inference away. Yeah. There's a MIU next is of 1, where n is 1. That would be rule 1 applied to everything in x, or applied to x, because it's a string replace list, string replace list. And so that table becomes, in totality, all the consequences of everything in x. And unfortunately for the case of larger formal systems like there could be formal systems that have more axioms or more rules of inference. In the case of first order logic, there only is one inference rule. And only one inference rule, modus ponens. So I haven't run this live yet. I should probably collapse everything. Hold on, don't mind me. I'm just gonna collapse everything. So you don't. I want to show you like how long it takes or doesn't take. Okay, so I can delete this. I'm gonna save this. This is actually being saved on my drive, so as soon as I crack open my other computer, this, now that I saved it, it'll be right there. So that's pretty cool. Even though it's not, it's physically like, I think it's on this laptop physically, but for 200 megabytes, everything on this computer is copied also in the cloud. So I'm not really afraid of, if someone steals my laptop, I'll be like, it should help with your insomnia, bro. You know, it's not much on there, you know, of interest. You know, there's nothing incriminating, like in the criminal sense, you know, on my computer. So let's run this. No, I should have showed that to you. Okay, so I didn't have it tell me MI. This is G of MI. So what G does is it lists all the consequences of everything in X. So G is a function of X here. Here, meow. My cat's here. She's here. Yes. She didn't want to move. She's obstinate and unyielding. She is obstinate and unyielding. This is where it gets really stupid. No, I'm just kidding. I love this song. This is the same thing. Let's look at memory available. I have 24.83009536 gigabytes. I think, no, 24 billion bits. Yeah, Those aren't bites, are they? It's, no, if those were bites, that'd be fucking insane. 24 billion. 25 billion. It is billion, right? 100,000 million, yeah, but 24 billion. You can see it puts spaces in between the numbers. I can't highlight them, but it separates every third block, or every block of three, blocks it with spaces. So now let's run the whole thing. Nothing will happen in terms of breaking the world record. And that's the thing here. There's this website. So what you can see, might be able to sort of feel that when you look at this, it's repeating something over and over. But like here, it's like temp 4, and if I go up a little higher, it'll say temp 3. Okay, so it's repeating something over and over. What's it repeating? Basically, it's applying G, which is this G right here, G of temp, the kth element of temp 1. So temp 1 is G of G, G of temp 1 is temp 2, and then so on and so on. I didn't need this one here, just so you know. I put it in just for my own, like, peace of mind, like, because I'm thinking of, like, the same thing when you do an integral or a summation, there's a starting point. Like, so if, I know it assumes that it's one if I don't have it, but old habits die hard, and I learned Mathematica when it was version 4.5, now they're, like, on... they're working on 14, I think. They have 13 out right now. So let's run this code. My computer has never been able to do this code, and I'm not going to create an hour video while staring at the screen, but I'll show you what it does. Because the current timestamp. So, yeah, the OES website. So the numbers we're looking for are here, 136, 11, 25, 69, so it's calculating them right now. So you got 6, 11, 25, this big number is the amount of memory I've got left, and you can see that it's hovering at 920, then it goes down by a little bit, a few thousand. So my memory is like steadily going, no, it's sometimes it went up. Interesting. It went up after this one. I don't know what that means. And then 282, 1730, that's in this 282, 1730. It's calculating these things for right now. And the world record is, see, this is the end, that's the highest known number of this sequence. And then, so, let's show it in a slightly different way. And, so I didn't use my program on MI, because we already know that MI proves MI because it's an axiom citation, one-step proof. Just say MI is true because MI is an axiom, and that's where pretty much define axioms to be true, at least in the area we're working in. So 3, 6, 11, 25, 69. So A of 12 is known to be this, which is 106 million. Okay, that's 106 million. I expect it. See, nobody knows what A13 is. We've tried Java, Python, and I just finished this really stupid short program in Mathematica. And everything's running out of memory. Like, he tried it, this guy named, probably doesn't even want to be mentioned here, Sean Irvine, I assume that's how you pronounce it. We communicated briefly, and I told him I was interested in this sequence. And he got back to me, and he told me how to run the Java program, which I did. Finally, it took some effort to figure that out. It's totally like, how do most people who don't have a familiarity with computers do this? You know, it's like, I guess he, I don't know. Good thing I had computers when I was in school. What you're looking at right now is the Python version of the code. What it's doing is it's counting, so for the nth term in the sequence, say n is 1, n is 2, n is 3. So n is the first column. And again, a of 13 is not known. It's not because the list goes down further on the screen. That's all that we know is just 12. And what I'm trying to do is find the 13th number before anyone else. And I would like to do it because I wonder if it suddenly exploded, like, you know, now there's a Google Manny theorems, you know, or did it suddenly shrink a lot? Did it go up as much as I expect it to be, about 20 times as large as this? The zero, because it seems to add a digit every time. But see, it added two digits for A of 12. There's two extra digits, that's 10 squared. And so it might be up to 100 times 100 billion, million, sorry, 100 times 100 million, would be a squared times a to the 7, so that's 7 to the 9, which is 1 billion. So I expect it to be around a billion. No, that would only be 10 times. Wait, did I say 10 times? Okay, so 10 times that is about a billion. And then, so yeah, I expect it to be 10 squared times 10 to the 8th, which would be 10 billion. Yeah, 10 billion is what I expect it to be around. And, well, you might think, like, okay, 10 billion, but that's... That's around 10 gigabytes, right? Or gigabits. Damn. So now what I recently tried with Mathematica is to lower the memory at each step. I mean, you know, clear old ones. Here. So date string, it just prints out the time. It's a timestamp that goes in between every one of these, so it tells me how long it took. The temps followed by number are the values of the sequence, A of 1 through A of 12. It does go up to 12, but it always runs out of memory for 13 for all of us. And I've tried it on Mathematica, Python, and Java. I didn't write the Python or the Java. I just use it. And I guess that's what a lot of people do. They just rip shit off other people. But that's kind of silly, because if it has bugs, you're like, you have no idea where that bug is. You know, you have to test every single if, then, whatever. I wouldn't want to borrow someone else's code if my life depended on it. Let's see, so... Temp 10 is going to be a table of G of previous temp. So I want to flatten that and then take all duplicates and get rid of them. Now the parallel part is telling it to use all available kernels to do this. Parallel table is a very cool thing if you want to parallelize your tables, like this one. And at each step, it clears one of the previous temps, and then this is a check on the memory, followed by repeating that over and over. And I think it's still working. Yeah, it's still working. See the hours? It's 8 seconds for both. That's because it was so fast. It took 1 second to count 282. And the memory went, available memory went up. And available memory went way down. 154. And that's interesting. Free memory went up. I think it must be good to clear the old variables. I haven't actually ran the whole thing with that, because it can literally go one day before it quits, and I have 32 gigs of memory. By the way, Java quit at A of 11, it just stopped, and Python could generate A of 12, but ran in memory also. Mathematica can get up to A of 12 also. So this is the parallel table window. It tells me that I have 4 kernels working on this. It's been thinking about this for 7 minutes, that many seconds. And there's only 28 minutes left. That's cool. When it gets to the last one, it'll be like 2,000 evaluations, and each one is like 200,000, I think, because it takes longer and longer each time. like exponentially last time. So I don't know. I'll let you know if anything happens, but so far it's like I need a better computer. Something with like, actually I think RAM is all I need. I don't even need a CPU, a good CPU, because it doesn't matter to me how long it takes, but it won't go through it all without RAM. So I have to raise money. It's time to raise money.